Beautiful day. It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord. Yay. Well, General Conference finished up, if you paid any attention to it. And there were some decisions made and what have you, and then, you know, one of them, we decided to kick the can down the road and form a commission to study and all this kind of mess. So, anyway, there still is a United Methodist Church today. So, at least for the next 2 or 3 years. We'll see what happens after that. I certainly don't know. I don't have it figured out. Certainly a good opportunity for us to pray for God's leadership, right? Because I certainly don't have it figured out. I can tell you what I think, but, you know, I'm just one person out of, how many, 11, 12 million? Yep. So my personal opinion probably doesn't amount to a whole lot. But on the issue of sexuality, the General Conference was at a loggerhead. There was going to be a big vote on, like, I don't know how many different items. Anyway, long story short, they decided to form a commission that were appointed by the bishops to study and come up with a separate General Conference in 2 to 3 years to try to nail that down once and for all for us. So, there you go. And you know, of course, there's all kinds of anxiety about that already in a lot of different circles, and, you know, certainly two major circles on that. You know, everybody's looking now to see who the bishops will appoint, you know, what kind of, you know, commission it is made up, because historically the bishops have leaned toward the progressive side in their appointments. So I know the conservatives are saying, well, let's see. So anyway, pray about all that. And, you know, that God can lead that in a way that I certainly don't know or have figured out. And I'm hoping that, because I only see one or two options myself. But anyway, that's going forward. There was one thing that was accomplished that I would share with you, that if you're on the conservative bent, was a victory. There was an organization that United Methodist Women and Board of Church and Society have been members of for 40 years. It's called the RCRC is the initials, something about reproductive choice and all that sort of thing. Basically, it was a pro-abortion group that these two agencies have been a part of since it was founded, since that organization was founded. And General Conference voted to have them withdraw immediately from that, because that does not go along with United Methodist theology, the Book of Discipline, our Book of Resolution. None of it doesn't go along with anything, because we don't agree with abortion for, you know, on demand, basically, at any trimester, whatever. So they had to pull out. So that was one good thing, I think. And it's been one of my issues with the United Methodist Women, not locally, but as a national organization, is their progressive bent. So anyway, I'll say all that. Y'all know where I'm coming from, I figure, by now. But so anyway.
Really tell. You want to explain that?
I'm sorry.
I said, go ahead and really tell us where you're coming from.
Well, that's pretty much, you know, yeah, y'all know. Anyway, do pray, because I certainly don't have it all figured out, but God's making a way here at all this, and I hope and pray that he is. Anyway, there is a district conference on Tuesday night at 6 o'clock at First Church Lufkin to get ready. Certainly the people that are going as representatives from the congregation, like Don from here and myself and other people, are going to the annual conference in Houston as delegates for the churches, or and anybody else that wants to could go down there, and they're kind of going to preview what's going to be discussed at annual conference. And I really don't know what all that'll be. Everything, you know, a lot of stuff they vote for at general conference, we have to ratify at the annual conferences. Right now, I don't know. So if you're interested, go Tuesday night to First Church Left into the Fellowship Hall, 6 o'clock. Okay. Annual conference for the Texas Annual Conference starts next Sunday night in Houston. And Kim and I will be there for those 3 days until Wednesday. So just messes up a good Memorial Day weekend. I don't know.
What time do you have?
Chance
to gather with your brethren.
So anyway, huh?
Chance to gather with your brethren.
Well, yeah, but it is good. It's a good, yeah. You get, it's a really a blessing because you've got some good worship and you can see a lot of good Methodist friends. So anyway, and we have a visitor with us today named David Bockwith from Timpson.
I go by Adam, my middle name.
Huh?
I go by my middle name.
Oh, okay. Which is, what'd you say?
Adam
Bockwith. I'm sorry. Okay. Glad you're here with us today. And you had to sit through all this. Sorry about that. But it was kind of a big week for the Methodist Church, I guess, wherever you're from. So anyway, it was kind of a hurry up, wait moment, you know. Y'all got all dressed up and then now there's nowhere to go kind of thing. So here we go. We'll see how that all goes. But do pray for your United Methodist Church. We're glad you're here. And we'll have Sunday school class next hour if you want to stick around next door. There's coffee anyway. You can go get coffee before you have to go. We got our regular slate of activities this week, I guess.
Yes, one thing, Ronnie, in the bulletin is the location of your Wednesday night.
Yes.
But I've got it corrected for next week.
Okay, good. Because I didn't do the bulletin this week. Thank God. That was a training day too. Oh, anyway.
We need you to sign up for the scripture and prayer. I need a scripture for next Sunday and the rest of June.
All right. So, yeah, the Bible study will be at our house now. Jolly Jack's is crowded and noisy, and we've made people mad and got up and hoofed out, you know, from the upstairs, and it gets hot up there, you know, this time of the year. Yeah, we had, one of the last times, we had somebody kind of hollered and stomped out, him and his girlfriend, went and told on us. Got in trouble, they had to come up and get on to us and all that.
Christians are gathering up.
I know, yeah, right. So we said, you know, we might all take it somewhere else. Well, yeah, but it was good for a while.
We had some of the best dumplings I ever put in my mouth.
Yeah.
We did.
Kim did that for us.
That's all by grace of God.
Watch out, everybody's going to start wanting to come down.
Right.
It's chicken spaghetti this week, though. So Wednesday night, 6:30, or us, maybe. We'll see. Possible. All right, let's see. Any other announcements? Sorry, y'all. I had to get off on all that. Oh,
Sunday.
I can't see you for the
huh?
Fifth Sunday.
Is it next week? It's fifth Sunday? Maybe. Well, y'all want to do something?
Is it fifth Sunday?
Yeah.
Probably.
So we need to have a brunch. So we're ready for brunch.
All right. Brunch next Sunday.
Brunch. Bring whatever.
Brunch, lunch.
Bring something. So whatever. Meat preferably.
Okay, then. Yeah.
Or not.
We're on this for the night.
All right. tonight, y'all. So brunch next Sunday. That'll work. All right. Anything else? Okay. Then Don Clark's going
to
pray.
I am. I'm glad to be back. I missed two.
Yeah. Two or three or something.
Let us pray, friends. Dear Heavenly Father, your Spirit has drawn us here together again. We come to praise and worship you in what we say and do here today, not only really in this hour of worship, but also on into the rest of this coming week. May your presence surround us and help us be good disciples. Inspire us, we pray, to grow into the people that you created us to be. We look for you to do this, dear God, because on our own, we're too often tempted to be just the opposite of what you created us to be. All this we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. All right, we're going to stand and affirm our faith together on page 881, right? I don't think it's on the slide. Y'all probably know this by heart. You know it's in the hymn book, page 881. So what we say with our lips, may we believe in our hearts. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our opening song.
It's the hymn of promise. One of the things I always like about this, it reminds us that there's still a lot of mystery about and things we don't understand that only God knows.
Oh. Thank you.
trusting that she will not lead him astray. When she returns to the shelter of the barn each evening, she stops occasionally and looks back, making sure her friend isn't too far behind to hear the bell. Like the owner of these two horses, God does not throw us away just because we're not perfect or because we have problems or challenges. He watches over us and even brings others into our lives to help us when we are in need. Sometimes we are the blind horse, being guided by the little ringing bell of those who God places in our lives. Other times we are the guide horse, helping others see the way. Please listen for my bell, and I'll listen for yours. Some people are blind even though they can see with their eyes because they don't understand that Jesus is the Son of God. This unbelief causes darkness in their hearts and minds. Jesus tells us we are the light of the world and to let our light shine in such a way that others can see that we serve God. This may be just what others need to understand, that Jesus loves them. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, please help us deliver your light and your word to the children who are in darkness. Help us to listen to God's bell when he calls. Thank you for loving us even when we are not perfect.
Has anybody received a blessing they'd like to share with us today? A praise? Kim?
If you follow Facebook, I posted it. But Matthew had a terrible accident. He rode his truck. He's only been driving for almost 3 weeks. And if you saw the image of his truck, you know it's a miracle that he is alive. There's nothing wrong with him. He just has a little bit of whiplash. He's not hurt. There's no way he could have came out of that without God's grace. And I'm just telling you, Rick and I talk about this all the time. We pray for our kids and all the kids, and prayer works, It works. If you haven't seen a miracle, you just heard of one. So I'm just encouraging you guys, when things are not going your way, it's God's way. So keep praying and continue to pray for all the kids. Please.
Yeah, I'm sure Pete's rolled up on a lot of accidents that weren't nearly as bad and, had a much worse result than what, we are thankful. He rolled it three times. It rolled three times across the highway and into the ditch, a 10-foot deep ditch. So, hit a tree.
The cab is crushed.
It's a miracle. So we just hope he realizes that, But anyway,
His concern was his truck. And I said, son, I don't think that's fixable. I think that one's total.
He wasn't.
Yeah. Anybody else?
I have some unspoken prayers. And she always makes me feel so good when she calls, because I feel like that she trusts us to pray for the people that she asks us to pray for. And I think she believes that God hears our prayers, not more than anybody else's, but still it's makes me feel good that she calls to ask us to pray, and she's had some unspoken requests that she would like for us to pray for this morning.
I think there's one way that's worked for me to understand God's love for us is our family, how we feel toward our families, our children and our brothers and sisters and so on. And I say that just because this last week was on a family reunion with my brothers and sisters, which was put together since both my father and mother had died, and it's been getting better every year, really. And I feel blessed, really, by God that our family, brothers and sisters, get along so well. You know, maybe it has to do with the old days when we didn't have any playmates other than one another. You know, we didn't have any neighbors. But it was refreshing to go and be with them and remember when we were kids. And today, too, I guess, some of that, too.
You learn a lot of lessons from your family. Woo! For sure. And they still love us, you know, in spite of us, right? Woo! Anybody else? Prayer? Go ahead.
Blessing coming this week, and Shane called and said, we're coming, don't make any plans. So they come in Friday night and leave in Monday, so I think it's a work weekend. Which is good. It'll be fun, and I'll be cooking.
Yes, ma'am.
God bless me with 16 years of marriage, and bless my husband with a job for
Yay! All right, then. Well, that's a double whammy in 1 week. Job promotion. So what was, can you say? Is it okay to say what it was? What the promotion was? All right then. Yay.
I've got another praise.
All right.
And a confession. Praise. You know, when you have incidents like what I just went through, you just never know how you're going to react. Praise is, by God's grace, I didn't fall apart.
Not right then, anyway.
And the other praise is, I'm so thankful that my ex didn't fall apart. Because, you know, he could have been calmer, he could have been volatile. So I was concerned, and he really did well. And I'm just going to praise God for that, because, you know, I still struggle praying for him. And I do it because my son's request. Started out with my son's request. And you know, it's hard to pray for those that you have a problem with. And God's always, I think he's, you know, teaching me. That's why I pray for the others. So, over this incident, it just reaffirmed the fact that God is always right. We have to pray for those that we, you know, it's easy to pray for people that you love. It's hard to pray for those who upset you. And I just want to say, I'm like the rest of you. It's hard for me to do that. But I do it because I do it for my son. But now I do it because I want God to work in them too. Not that I'm perfect, but I'm, you know, and I want it to be good for them too. So I just wanted to share and confess. Thank you, Lord.
Just want to tell everybody I started going back. I used to go to the meditation at the Episcopal Church, and that's with one S. They always told me that. I shouldn't even say it, but I used to go there. And I shouldn't say it. But I went to meditation. It's about 30 minutes on Tuesday at 5:30. It's very unthreatening. It was, to me, the best prayer time I've had in many, many moons. It's just sitting there about 10 minutes to where they played some, you know, about a 10-minute talk from Richard Rohr, you know, famous, you know, theologian. And then to think about that, or I did think about that, but to pray, do whatever you want. and sit in silence and commune with God. Did the world good for me, you know. And so, anybody that's free at 5:30, come by the Episcopal Church, go in the south door, southwest door, you know, and join us.
Yes, ma'am.
Stephanie had her first injection Monday, so hopefully that will work.
She had it last?
She had it last
time. Oh, okay.
So, I mean.
She get any relief? Or?
A little bit.
A little bit, yeah.
So, anything will help right now.
Yes, ma'am.
We finished up the FAF, and it was a wonderful year.
Amen, amen. And as a result of the hard work that team of folks have been doing, there were six that accepted Christ here about 3 weeks ago. So it's all on what y'all have done, you know, this church has done to reach out to those kids. So thanks be to God. Yeah.
We're so. Starting a terrific Tuesday pretty soon, and want all to come out and have fun with us. We don't know what we're
going to
be doing.
Well,
it's
going to
be fun.
And if you haven't filled out one of those forms for the Bible study on when you want, when you can come and what you're interested in and so forth, please do fill out one of those forms. Because in a Sunday or two, I'm probably going to be asking to see how many we have coming to see if we have enough to make the study.
All right, concerns? Any? Yes, ma'am.
Just prayer for the family of Bonnie Elsberry. That's Denise Wallace's mother passed away this week. The family had graduation here in the Fellowship Hall in the Christian Life Center Saturday, was a week ago, and the twins. Grandsons graduated from SFA. They were, Stephanie and the boys were a big part of our after school program in the past. And Denise and John have been members here. Just prepare for that family. They got through the graduation and everything. And that's the way I believe it. So.
Any others? Adam?
Pray for my work situation. I work at Pilgrim's, and things are getting pretty hectic up there right now. And plus, my work schedule, they have me working 4 a.m. to 1 p.m., which I really don't like those hours. So I'm trying to go back to third shift, possibly. He said I could. It's just I don't know when. It's a matter of them hiring somebody and, you know, all that stuff. But hopefully that'll happen soon.
All right.
Yes,
ma'am.
Just need to put my mom on the prayer list. She's having a lot of problems right now, and we're just waiting for them to find space in that new generations unit so we can get her moved from assisted living to generations.
Okay. Sure.
For my friend that I worked with, her name's Debbie Bennett. When she said her, one of her sons to tell her other son that his grandmother had passed away, her son found her other son dead and had been dead for about a week.
Oh, God.
So, not only did she lose her mother-in-law, she lost her son.
Wow.
Ooh. He lived in Cedar Park.
Okay, others? Methodist Church, I'm going to throw the UMC on there. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer.
Holy God, you alone are holy and good and merciful and gracious and faithful and loving and kind. Lord, you've shown us your love through Jesus on the cross and by giving us the hope of resurrection in you, Lord. You have certainly shined your light of love toward us. Lord, help us to reach out to you, to keep holding on to you, to seek you with our whole hearts, to trust in you with all that we are and all that we have, to be faithful and obedient as you were here when you walked this earth. Lord, we lift up these prayer concerns that are on our hearts today. You've heard several of them mentioned. There are others that are on our prayer list, on our bulletin, and others on our heart that went unmentioned. Lord, we just lift all of these up to you and pray for you to touch and heal and make whole those that are broken right now. And Lord, continue to help us to be in ministry to them and others as you lead us, so that we might shine the light of your love, that love of Christ, into the hearts and lives of other folks around about us. Help us to be your church, Lord, to represent you in this world, and point folks back to you. We pray for our nation. We pray for President Obama, for all those who are in positions of authority. We pray your hand upon them, that you'd give them wisdom to lead. We pray for our military men and women, that you would put your hedge of protection around them and watch over them. And Lord, that you would bring revival to the United Methodist Church, Lord, and help to heal us too, Lord, because we are broken. Continue to work in us, Lord. Help us, Lord, to seek and know you, and to reach out to those who don't know you, Lord, and to help point them to you, that they might come to know you as Lord. We do pray for revival in our nation. We continue to pray that the good news about your Son would sweep not only across our land, but across the face of the earth, and that all peoples everywhere would hear the good news about your Son, Jesus, and come to know you as Lord. Remember now all that you've done for us. We remember the passion, and we remember your resurrection and the hope we have in you. And we also remember how your Son Jesus taught us how to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Well, that's your please. Lord, please bless these tithes, gifts, and offerings that are given, and use them to bring you glory and reach the lost for the sake of your name. In Christ's name we pray. Thank you.
See, Pat, are you, would you, can you read that? Okay.
So Christ has truly set us free. Now make sure that you stay free and don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. Listen, I, Paul, tell you this. If you are counting on circumcision to make you right with God, then Christ will be of no benefit to you. I'll say it again. If you are trying to find favor with God by being circumcised, you must obey every regulation in the whole law of Moses. For if you are trying to make yourselves right with God by keeping the law, you have been cut off from Christ. You have fallen away from God's grace. But we who live by the Spirit eagerly wait to receive by faith the righteousness God has promised us. For when we place our faith in Christ Jesus, there is no benefit in being circumcised or being uncircumcised. What is important in faith expressing itself is love. Galatians 5, verses 6.
Thank you. DNA evidence was first used in court cases in 1989 to help, well, it came to be used to help exonerate some of the people who had been convicted of crimes and already put in prison. Since 1989, there have been 341 individuals who have gotten freedom, who've been set free from prison because of DNA evidence proved that they were not the one who perpetrated the crime. And a majority of those had an eyewitness that said they were the one who did it. So 20 of those 341 were actually on death row somewhere in this nation. And their cases were thrown out, or they were exonerated or whatever, because of DNA evidence proved that they weren't the ones who did it. Interesting. I hope I never have to prove my innocence on the witness stand, you know, because you never know how that can go. Honest to goodness, you know. Look at what they tried to do to Jesus, you know. Those witnesses got up and testified against him and, you know, tried to railroad him, and it worked. Well, it's hard to imagine, you know, being falsely accused of something or being imprisoned and having to trust in a court system to set us free. It's I don't know. I mean, I believe in our judicial system, but I don't think I believe in it that much if it's me sitting up there, right? So the good news is, we're all guilty, or the bad news is we're all guilty, right? We're all sinners. We've all broken God's law. We've messed up. I mean, we all deserve what we get. And I'm not going to tell you what that is. You know, right? We deserve the wrath of God that has been poured out on us. But the good news is, when we look to Jesus Christ, we are set free. We are set free from that bondage to the law. We are set free from being convicted from guilt of sin. We're set free from getting what we deserve, right? We are set free. Jesus sets us free. Jesus said in John 8, I tell you the truth, everyone who sins is a slave of sin. A slave is not a permanent member of the family, but a son is a part of the family forever. So if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed, right? So Jesus is the Son of God who sets us free from that yoke of slavery to sin and death, right? So By faith, we are set free. By believing, trusting with our whole hearts in Jesus and following Him, trusting Him with all that we are and all that we have, right? I mean, it's not just some kind of intellectual assent. Oh yeah. No, it's all in. You got to get all in. You know, go all in with it. Say, yeah, I believe with everything I am. It's all true. And the cool thing is, when we do that, we're set free from the law, in a sense, right? The book of Hebrews says this, and this is quoting, I believe it's Isaiah, or Ezekiel, quoting God in Ezekiel, says, "But this is the new covenant I will make with the people of Israel in that day, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds, and I will write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people." That's Hebrews 8:10, right? That's pretty cool. That's real cool. Any of y'all on the Deep East Texas electrical system? Some of y'all are. Thursday afternoon, I got home and my garage door wouldn't work. I was just hitting that button, you know. What's wrong? And then it hit me. I'm like, oh, power's out. I mean, it's a little afternoon. It was kind of a murky day, but somehow, you know, something went wrong, and electricity for that whole area just went out. You know, so we had to, you know, get out the key. I was like, do I even have a key to the door? Do y'all? And I did, you know, miraculously. So I went in front of them, and, you know, we were bebopping around. And of course, you can't do anything much, you know. The electricity's off, right? We had no power. You know, the kids were wanting to get on their iPads and stuff. And of course, I'm sitting here thinking, you know, I need to check on this, that, and the other. I want to check on general conference, all that stuff on the web. You can't do it, baby. I mean, everything was down. I got out there and yanked on my old generator. Until Caleb and I nearly threw our backs out yanking on that thing. We finally gave up. But we had no power, y'all. There was no power. So, guess what? When we're trying to follow the law, for the law's sake, right? We're doing it without power, you know? And that's what these Judaizers were trying to do back in Paul's day. They were trying to tell these early Christians, you got to be little Jews too. You got to follow the law. You know, you got to be circumcised. You know, you got to follow all the laws of Moses. Guess what? That's the first five books of the Old Testament is the law of Moses. There's a lot of stuff in there, y'all. Woo! I don't want to have to follow that. I mean, I don't know about you, but woo-wee. That's a lot. I mean, have y'all ever read Leviticus? Seriously? Woo-wee. It's scary. If you can just wade through it to begin with. I mean, I have trouble every time I get to it. In Deuteronomy, it's like, woo, man. That's tough stuff. It's hard to read. But that's what the early Jews all were trying to get these Christians to do, to become little Jews, right? But there was no power in it. The power, y'all, is in Jesus. Y'all, I hope this doesn't offend anybody. I thought it was kind of cute. So when we're trying to follow the law for the law's sake, we can't do it. You can't do it, first and foremost, right? I mean, how many of us have ever tried to clean ourselves up so that we could come to God, right? Come to Jesus. Or we're going to straighten up and maybe even start going to church every now and then, right? I'm going to straighten up and start, you know. It don't work like that. You know, you can't do it, y'all. Church attendance isn't going to save you. A full immersion baptism won't save you. The Apostles' Creed that we just did ain't going to save you. Following The law of Moses won't save you. Doing good deeds, being a good person in the community, is not going to save you. Giving $1 million to SFA is not going to save you. Only faith in Jesus Christ can save us. And when we have that faith in Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes into us, comes into our hearts, and He guides us into all truth. Even the truth about how to follow Jesus. And here's a little caveat. The Holy Spirit's not gonna lead us in a direction that is not in keeping with God's Word. It's gonna, you know, because what John tells us, that the Word was with God in the beginning, and then the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So, I mean, Jesus is the Word, right? And Jesus sent His Spirit to be in us. So, I mean, you know, it's not gonna go in opposite directions. I'm sorry. But it's gonna be in harmony with what God's Word is. He's gonna lead us to do those things, to be the way that Jesus would have us to be, to represent Him in the world, to do those things that would be pleasing to God. How many of y'all have ever been skydiving? You have? All right then. Okay. Not me. I'm a little skittish of that, man. But you know, when you're a skydiver, Adam, I'm sure can testify, you strap that little parachute on your bag, and there might be a reserve.
It was a tandem dive.
Oh, it was a tandem. Okay, you were on somebody else's bag, right? Okay. Well, I mean, if you had gone by yourself, you know, if you'd gone back, right, you'd have done it on your own, right? So you strap that thing on, and you know, first problem for me would be taking that first step, right? That first step's a doozy. Woo! So, I mean, you step out and you're trusting your whole life to this little piece of nylon or whatever it's made out of. And that it's going to work, right? You know? I don't know about you, but I haven't gotten there yet, man. Woo! But this is what Jesus is wanting us to do, y'all. Same sort of thing. Take that step. Step out in faith and trust your whole heart and life to Him. Believe in Him enough to take that first step. And He'll be there with us to get us where we need to go, right? And then the important thing at the end of this passage of Scripture that Paul says is what is important is faith expressing itself in love. The way I like to put it is we input faith in Jesus, and love and obedience comes out of us. We put the faith in, and love and obedience to Jesus comes out. We had a wild game supper here a year or two ago, and I saw something here that I hadn't seen before. Some of the old boys had some deer steaks. I think you might have been one of them. I know John Crane had some deer steaks. And they got an old Coke bottle. You know, the old glass Coke bottles. You hardly ever see them anymore. But they were beating that deer meat with that glass bottle, the throat of it, you know, to tenderize it. Have y'all heard of that? Mm-hmm. And it kind of makes, it tenderizes those steaks. It did a pretty darn good job, I'd say. What happens when God, when we have that faith in God, when we step out in faith in Christ, God puts that Spirit, His Spirit in us, and that's kind of what the Holy Spirit does. He tenderizes our heart. He does that work on us that we can't do ourselves, right? If we're trying to follow the law, we can't do it. But God, through His merciful Spirit, begins a work in our hearts that we can't accomplish. And He tenderizes our old selfish, stony hearts, right? Now, what I want to say, God's love isn't a sappy, just sentimentality that just says, oh, honey, you're all right just like you are kind of business, you know. You know, yeah, he loves everybody, but he wants everybody to know Jesus. He wants to direct everybody to Jesus, right? This is the same Jesus that was famous for saying things like, go and sin no more, or stop sinning, or something worse will happen to you, right? So, I mean, Jesus is all about loving people where they're at, but he's also about saying, get on the right path, you know, follow God. Trust in me and I will lead you where you need to be going, right? So, and the Spirit again will not lead us in a way that is in contrast to God's Word, which is God's love letter to us, is His Word, right? I mean, that's love. Now Kim mentioned something a while ago. Faith expressed in love. Mentioned praying for people that we have problems with, right? I mean, we don't necessarily get along with too good, that we are in conflict with. I mean, that's hard to do, right? But the Spirit of God tenderizes our old stony heart and says, no, yes, you can. And you need to do it. And you need to take that step and trust in me and pray for those people and love them too. Right? I mean, it may not be a lot to begin with. It may just be a little bitty bit. You may have to get that microscope out, you know, to even see it. But trust in God and take that step and pray for them. And you know, who knows? Who knows? Stranger things have happened. You know, it's like if we're supposed to love God too, right? I mean, that's the first and foremost thing. And if we really love Jesus, if we really do, who are we going to want to please? Ourselves? Somebody else? Or Jesus? So when we want to live our lives, who are we going to try and please in the way we live our life? Christ, right? So our focus doesn't need to be the law, following the law, right? Our focus needs to be on Jesus and following Him, right? And pleasing Him, doing those things that are pleasing to Him, that affirm our love for Him. And one of the things is to love other people, right? Do you want to see anybody else go to hell? I'm going to just ask, you know. Do you want to see anybody else go to hell? No, I hope not. So let's love them. Let's reach out to them. And let's pray for God to give us ways to lovingly show them Jesus or move them in that direction some kind of way. So that even if we can't do it, maybe somebody else can, right? I mean, we don't have to always be the person that directs somebody to Jesus. If we can just direct them to somebody who can direct them, you know what I'm saying? Jesus says in John 15, there's no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. So we need to lay our lives down, you know, and be willing to say that word that may not be popular. It may be contrary to, you know, what's politically correct sometimes. To just say, you know, I love you enough to say this to you. Even though I understand that's not what's popular in our culture today. But you know what? I'm more concerned about your spiritual condition than I am what's politically correct. I want you to know the God that I serve. I mean, what would be wrong with that? DNA. DNA evidence. So when Jesus looks at us, does he see himself today? Does he see hearts that are filled with his spirit, that are trying to follow him, that are trying to please him? Or are we trying to follow the law and be legalistic, you know, and check off, we've made it to church today, check that box off, right? Maybe I need to help an elderly lady cross the road or something, you know, do my good deeds of the day or something, right? Just love Jesus, you know? Just love him, and it'll all work out. Show your love to him, follow him, trust in him, and take that step, and be willing to continue to take those steps of stepping out on faith, and God will take care of the rest of it. He will. And our hearts will be tender and loving toward others. Even sometimes those that we don't really necessarily agree with one situation or another. Okay. So I'm going to shut up. Okay. So when Jesus looks at us, he sees his son. Or when God looks at us, he sees his son, Jesus Christ. That DNA evidence of the presence of Christ exonerates us, right? It sets us free. So that's what Christ has done for us. And he wants us to just follow his son, Jesus, and listen to him, and let the Spirit lead us. Walk in the Spirit. Walk in that faith and trust God. Amen? All right, we're going to say, sing our closing hymn here, and I probably got the wrong hymn. I messed up. Oh, sorry. Oops! I got the wrong PowerPoint.
We know it.
It's 369.
Yeah, that's the wrong one.
Yeah. We know it.
It's all Lucy's fault.
Don't forget there's something.